So,
I will confine myself to a few brief remarks on anti-systemic movements. The term anti-systemic movement dates from the 1970s and 1980s, and it was coined by Emmanuel Wallerstein, Giovanni Arrighi, Samir Amin, and Andrew Gunder Frank. What they meant by the term was self-evident to them. An anti-systemic movement was a movement that rejected capitalism. It was anti-capitalist. Today, if we look at Western Europe, the objective meaning of this term, if we wish to retain it, has altered. It is altered because there are no longer any significant political forces in Western Europe that demand an end to capitalism. That has become a taboo issue. The system today against which movements do arise is the neoliberal order of capitalism in Western Europe. An economic, political, and ideological order. Economically, a radically deregulated free market capitalism. Political order, an entirely fused, bipartisan political establishment in which center-right and center-left are all but completely interchangeable. I need only point out that in France, the current socialist government of François Hollande is introducing now much more radical cuts in welfare and bigger handouts to capital than the center-right government of Nicolas Sarkozy was able to do some years back. Similarly, in Germany, the neoliberal reforms in that country, the neoliberal changes, were the work of the Schröder social democratic government, not the Merkel government, which has been more moderate in that respect. Ideological order. The ideological order is what the French call pensée unique, el pensamiento único, the idea that there is no alternative to neoliberalism. Now, against this order, not one, but two kinds of anti-systemic movement have arisen. You have the left variants, which, as it were, speak for themselves, and so on. They clearly are against, and so on, neoliberalism. But you also have very significant variants of the right. Movements which are not anti-capitalist, but the left movements no longer speak of the end of capitalism either. But the right variants are anti-neoliberal, and often radically anti-neoliberal. So in this new situation, you have a convergence of agendas on common terrain. If we look at the panorama of Western Europe today, two observations strike one. Firstly, there are more right than left variants of anti-systemic protest and movement. In France, the Front National. In Britain, the United Kingdom Independence Party. In Italy, the Northern League. In the Netherlands, the Freedom Party. In all the Scandinavian countries, Sweden, Norway, Denmark, and Finland, similar parties and so on are there. In Germany now, newly, the Alternative für Deutschland. In Greece, the Golden Dawn. The left variants are fewer in number. The principal ones we think of, Syriza in Greece, Podemos in Spain, the Five Star Movement in Italy, and Sinn Féin in Ireland. You have much smaller political groups in Germany and in France, Die Linke or the Front de Gauche, which occupy somewhat similar position, but they are not nearly so, not such major forces. Second observation, many of the right movements are organizations predating the crisis of 2008. That's true of the Front National, of the Lega, of the Danish People's Party, of Golden Dawn, for example. Whereas the leading left variants, Syriza, Podemos, the Five Star Movement, are products directly of the crisis. They post-date 2008, some like, of course, Podemos are so recent that they were born this year. Next point. What is the relative electoral weight of these anti-systemic movements? Well, if we look at the last European elections, on the right, the Front National was the largest party in France, 25% of the vote. The UKIP was the largest party in Britain, 28% of the vote. In Denmark, the Danish People's Party, 26% of the vote, also the largest party. European elections are a little bit special. If you look at the national elections, these parties oscillate somewhere between 13 and 20%, or 13, 18%. If we look at the left, at the last national elections, Syriza got some 27% of the vote. The Five Star Movement in Italy about 25% of the vote. And if we look simply at opinion polls today, Podemos and Sinn Féin are both, in Spain and in Ireland, the largest countries, theoretically, the largest parties in the country, with about 26 to 27% of the electorate saying that they will vote for them. In other words, what we see are movements which oscillate between 1/6 and 1/4 of the electorate. When they're 1/6 of the electorate, let's say 13, 14%, they are not really a threat to the system in any serious sense. When they reach 1/4 of the electorate, they become a very serious headache for the system, particularly when the other traditional parties themselves have very poor scores, and so on below 25%. Next point, the social bases. What are the social bases of these movements? It's tricky to generalize, but roughly speaking, we can say some of the right movements have one very strong working class basis. That is true in both France and Italy, where the Front National and the Lega North are the strongest working class parties in the sense that they have the strongest working class base in the country. Also true, considerable number of workers in both Denmark and the Netherlands and so on vote for the local anti-systemic right movements. And in Britain, they are starting to, some workers are also starting to move in this direction. When we speak of workers here, I'm referring not just to employed workers, but to unemployed workers, and they often, and the unemployed, vote in large numbers and so on for these kind of parties. In addition, of course, the right movements have a classical petit bourgeois constituency. Small traders, shopkeepers, entrepreneurs, depressed white-collar workers, and pensioners, the elderly. They have very few professionals, and what they completely lack, they have no support from big business, and they have no intellectual dimension, typically at all, no intelligentsia. The left movements, Syriza and the Five Star Movement in particular, of course also have quite a strong working class appeal. So there's an overlap and so on in that area. But distinguishing them typically is the high generational change, the big youth component of these left movements. Students, very often, but not only students, young unemployed people or employed people. I think that's probably also true, clearly, of Podemos. And these movements, unlike the right-wing movements, do have strength, typically in the professional classes and among intellectuals. What about organization? There are two versions. You have parties of a semi-cader type. That is, ones with a traditional structure, membership, militance, and discipline. These kind of organizations predate the, as it were, crisis, and or typically they predate the crisis. So if you look at the Front National, the Lega Nord on the right, or the Linke Izquierda Unida, or Sinn Féin on the left, these are organizations predating the crisis, and they have more or less, not very strong typically, but they have more or less traditional party membership structures. Then you have parties today that are much more like movements in this very strict sense. They are less structured, less parliamentary, more street strong. And these parties are typically products directly of the crisis, drawing energy out of the popular protests against the crisis. So the Indignados, out of that came Podemos in Spain. Out of the massive popular demonstrations against the Troika in Greece came the success of Syriza. Out of the huge Vaffa assemblies in Italy, organized by Beppe Grillo, emerged the five-star movement there. Leadership. There's a common pattern to these anti-systemic movements, which is the key role of charismatic leaders in them. It's a very striking feature. On the right, Marine Le Pen, Matteo Salvini in Italy, Nigel Farage in England, Geert Wilders in the Netherlands. These are all very gifted, capable, charismatic leaders. They speak very well, powerfully, have a strong following. On the left, the same phenomenon. Syriza, Alex Tsipras, Podemos, Pablo Iglesias, five-star movement in Italy, Beppe Grillo, and so forth. This feature corresponds, in my view, not just to the postmodern personalization of politics, but also to the rather limited material resources and unstructured organization of these movements, these anti-systemic movements. Issues. What are the issues around which the contemporary anti-systemic movements mobilize in Western Europe? For the anti-systemic movements of the right, there are typically, of course, three issues. First and foremost, immigration, but immigration connected also to social protection. Two things go together. Second issue is austerity, the battle against austerity, rejection of the straitjacket of the single currency, the euro, hostility to bank bailouts of the banks, and generally a rejection of the neoliberal economic order as such. Third issue is the issue of popular sovereignty, the radical rejection of the dictation of political decisions in each country by an unelected oligarchy in Brussels, an insistence and so on that there should be instead nationally based democracies. On the left, what you see is that of these three issues I've listed, two are common to the left too, because the left too rejects neoliberal austerity and all its disastrous social consequences. It too attacks the unelected eurocratic oligarchy in Brussels. The difference is, of course, that the left movements do not stress immigration, and they do stress, typically rather more emphatically, anti-imperialist foreign policy. I will just conclude then with the following remark. In many countries, only one kind of such movement of significance exists, that is, on the right. That would be true in Scandinavia and in Britain. In Greece, Italy, and France, both types, right and left, coexist and compete directly on the same terrain. In Spain, on the whole, uniquely, it's the only country in Europe where there is only one major anti-systemic movement, and that is on the left, which is Podemos. I'll stop there.
Hola, buenas tardes. Yo querría agradecer también todo lo que hemos aprendido esta tarde, pero querría hacer un pequeño comentario sobre todo la exposición del señor Anderson, porque me ha sorprendido un poco que cuando habla de movimientos anticapitalistas, aparte de que coincido con él de que hay muy poco en el sentido de que ya no hablamos de anticapitalismo, a lo más es hablar de neoliberalismo, que efectivamente no es lo mismo, pero me sorprende que usted hable solo de los partidos. Es decir, exclusivamente en términos de partidos políticos. En Grecia, Syriza, en España, Podemos, en no sé dónde, no sé qué. Bueno, me permito pensar que es una visión bastante limitada de lo que es la resistencia del futuro. Pienso que si realmente tenemos una esperanza de futuro, no está tanto en reproducir de alguna manera una estructura de partidos que es tradicional, pero que también ha demostrado y está demostrando sus limitaciones, sino en enfocar abiertamente que estamos viviendo sitios diferentes, momentos diferentes, composiciones de fuerzas diferentes, y que por lo tanto lo que los que nos queremos considerar de izquierda anticapitalista tendríamos que hacer es fundamentalmente ver cómo podemos estimular, ampliar, integrarnos en esos nuevos movimientos y olvidarnos un poco estrictamente de las formas tradicionales de actuación política. Y bueno, echo de menos que no se haya comentado un poco esto en su exposición, en las demás exposiciones tampoco, pero creo que constituye, me permito decirle, un diagnóstico y una estrategia pues un poquito anticuada, si me permite, en el sentido de que ya no nos valen las estructuras estrictas de partido. Puede ser positivo que algunos movimientos sociales se conviertan en partidos, puede ser. Pero creo que nuestra fuerza y nuestra capacidad de transformación realmente reside en nuevas expresiones completamente distintas de actuación y de trabajo político. Y que ahí tendríamos que estar presentando e intentando trabajar mucho para ver cómo podemos, a partir de estas cosas que están desintegradas, que están separadas, que no están organizadas a la manera tradicional, pero que es ahí donde reside nuestra fuerza para el futuro. Y por eso me permito hacer este pequeño comentario. Muchas gracias.
A very good question there. You're correct in saying that I focused my remarks principally on those movements which have become parties. They originally, many of them, were simply movements. That's true of even the Movimento Cinque Stelle in Italy denies that it is a party. It has representatives in Parliament, but it flatly denies that it's a party. It describes itself, and it certainly was originally, a movement. And there are many movements which certainly anti-systemic movements today in Europe, very impressive ones. You have some in Catalonia here, one thinks of Ada Colau and so on, and other figures and so on associated with this, which where the principal form of the protest is a movement form rather than a party form. But the general logic and so on of movements, if they wish to persist, is that they have to become parties, I think. Let me, if I may, I was disciplined in, after 10 minutes, I ceased talking as I was asked to do, but my comrades and so on had perhaps exceeded their time and so on some occasions. If I might be allowed just to finish the remark I was going to make, because I would like to provoke you a little bit further, if I may. What I was going to say was this. In certain countries of Western Europe, nationalist movements can also be anti-systemic in a secondary sense. In Britain and in Spain, the system in question is not the neoliberal order, but the post-imperial constitutional order left by two reactionary monarchies that corrupted and crushed Scottish and Catalan independence at roughly the same time in the early 18th century, installing the Hanoverian and Bourbon dynasties as ruling powers in these lands. Now today, we have nationalist movements in Scotland and in Catalonia that threaten the political system in each state quite seriously. Yet, are these also, or could they become, anti-systemic in the deeper socio-economic sense of the term? In Scotland, the answer possibly might even be yes, because the massive democratic and youth mobilization, which surprised everyone in the referendum on independence this autumn, a referendum failed, but it led to a huge surge of the Scottish National Party since the referendum, with a tremendous release of popular energy in that country. The Scottish National Party, this is the party and so on side of it, but this movement is much larger movement behind it. The Scottish National Party is quite moderate, but it has unleashed a dynamic which is greatly alarming, the duopoly of power in between the Conservative and Labour parties in London. What about Catalonia, where you can certainly tell me more than I can ask you? At any rate, as a foreigner would see it, you have an independentist bloc, which is a kind of center-left, center-right coalition between Convergencia y Unió and Esquerra. The presence of a conservative force like Convergencia is quite unlike the situation in Scotland. Would seem more retrograde. But in Spain, meanwhile, the meaning of the term system here is quite different too. Because what it designates is not just the composite post-imperial state, but the political order born of the so-called transition, in quote marks, of the 1970s. That is, if I may put it bluntly, the cowardly opportunist capitulation of the communist and socialist parties to the Franquista restoration of the Bourbon monarchy and the manipulative, discriminatory electoral system imposed at that same time. An opportunism which was suicidal for the Communist Party and advantageous to the Socialist Party. It is to the honor of Esquerra that alone in Spain at the time, it rejected this system as the only force to hold high the banner of the Second Republic. There is now a recent literature on Spain on the falsehoods and surrenders involved in the pact of the 1970s, the so-called transition to democracy. That literature arrives rather late, 40 years after the events. NLR, New Left Review, can be proud that it published a savage critique of the mystifications of the Pact of Moncloa and the rotten constitution of the time many, many years earlier. Today, happily, there is a chance that the system created then, based on the restoration of the odious Bourbon monarchy, a system whose complete corruption and degeneration is patent to all today, there's a happy chance that this will now be exploded and sprung into the air. And if the Catalan movements for independence contributed to such an outcome, they would become truly anti-systemic in a third sense. Thank you.